Good morning and welcome to Holy Trinity Church on this Sunday as we're here to worship together. Congratulations on making it to the early service on Daylight Savings Time weekend. Give yourselves a round of applause. Yeah, that's, there we go. Leo knows it was an accomplishment for him to be here this morning. Normally it'd be 8 o'clock right about now, but it's 9 today. And I want to, as we begin our time worshiping this morning, invite you to consider what you'll be doing this time tomorrow morning. Some of you will be in the office. Some of you might be in the classroom. On the road, in a hospital, at work, what'll you be doing at this time tomorrow morning? And I want us to think about this and to think about how might our worship in this moment, this morning, speak to and prepare us for our callings, the things that God has given us to do in our today, in our weeks, in our lives right now. Would you hear these words, this call to worship from Psalm 33, starting in verse 18. It says, "Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, that he may deliver their soul from death and keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord, for he is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy love. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you." We see this truth that the eye of the Lord is on those who put their hope in him, that his steadfast love is with us. So I want to encourage you with this truth this morning, that when you go out from here, even as you come here to worship, that God sees you, that his eye is on you, his love is with you. This simple but profound truth that as we come here, I want to invite you to be thinking about how the words we sing might go out with you into your day-to-day. That the gospel we proclaim, as we proclaim it, as we hear it proclaimed this morning, would you consider how does this speak to what God's given me to do this week? So I want to invite you to stand. And let's pray as we begin to enter this time of worship together. God, we thank you that you are with us, that you are our God who has set your eyes on us and set your love on us. God, would you hear our praise to you this morning as we praise you for who you are? And God, would you fill our hearts with these truths that we might go out from here and live well for you with the good news of your gospel ringing in our hearts tomorrow and this week? We pray these things in the Son of Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Let's worship together this morning.
The power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be saved. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings brings our chaos back into order. Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of Glory, the King of Glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Let's worship him.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, and worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain, worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You lay down your life, then I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. All that you've done for me.
Sing what love could remember.
What love could remember, no wrongs we have done. Omniscient, all knowing, he counts not their sum. Thrown into a sea without bottom or shore. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Would wait as we constantly roam. What Father so tender is calling us home. He welcomes the weakest, the vilest, the poor. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
lavished on us. His blood was the payment, his life was the cost. We stood neath the debt we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. So much more, praise the Lord. His mercy is more. They are many, his mercy is more. Praise the Lord, his mercy is more. Stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more. Our sins, they are many, his mercy is more.
Amen. Pray, Father, thank you for these truths. Thank you, God, that you have sent your son to save us, that we praise you, God, for what you have done in history in saving our souls. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Is Jesus God? And if he is, what are the implications of that? Back in college, a fellow student accused me, and by virtue of all Christians, of being pagans because we worship the man Jesus. That's part true. We do worship Jesus, and he is a man. But if he is just a man, then I will argue that the words that we are getting ready to say here on the screen don't have much weight, because how can we be assured that the sacrifice that Jesus gave for us is enough? But if he is God, which scripture clearly tells us that he is, then we know that we have been sanctified through the offering of Jesus Christ once for all. And so we know that the guarantor of our salvation is none other than the one who is the image of the invisible God and the radiance of God's glory. It is this Jesus, the God-man, that we worship. For those of you who are not familiar with the Christian faith, I want to extend a warm welcome and say that we are so glad that you are here. As we recite these words, I want you to consider what we're saying, reflect on them, and consider whether they're true. To the rest of us, I encourage you to join your voices with me as we affirm the words that we know are true. Please, recite the words of the Apostles' Creed with me. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. And the third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I want to ask you to please take your seats, and we'll call up Jesse and Sully. Thank you.
Thanks, David. Good morning, everybody. At this time, if you are going to be taking membership vows today, I want to ask for you to begin to make your way up to the front. I'll have you stand here to my right over by Jesse. As they are making their way forward, let me just say a word about membership here at Holy Trinity Church. We love church membership, and this is such an exciting day to be able to have these folks taking their vows. I'll have you stand over here to my right. No, you're good. In the scriptures, we find often that God is keeping an account of his people. Back in the book of Numbers, you see God telling the Israelite leaders to take an account, to take a census, to count each one of the people that are his. In Revelation, the final book of the Bible, we see this book of life where every name that has been given to Jesus, every person, their name is found in the book of life. Church membership, in some small way, is actually a reflection of the way that God keeps track of every single one of his people. And so here at Holy Trinity Church, we love church membership because it's our way of being able to say, these are the people who belong to the Lord. These are the people who are kept and held in God's hand. We also believe that in church membership, it's allowing us as pastors, as elders, as a community to say, hey, here are the people that we need to be, that we will be held accountable for one day before the Lord. So we are excited to welcome these new members to Holy Trinity Church. I'm grateful for each one of you, excited for you to take this step. I'm going to ask Jesse to say a word about our membership process, and then we'll have you guys introduce yourselves.
Yeah, these people have been pursuing if this is the local church they wanted to join. I guess some of you guys since the summer. But they have attended a membership class. They have met with an elder to walk through our covenant at HTC. And they stand before you today ready to take their membership vows with you guys. And so I'm so proud of them. I'm so excited for them. And I know many of them have already been serving and ready to plug into this local family and help move the kingdom of God forward. And so right now, I'm going to ask them to introduce themselves and what is their favorite thing about springtime in Chicago.
I'm Amber Hu, and my favorite thing is more daylight.
I'm Carlisle, and my favorite thing is the tulips on Michigan Ave.
I'm Abby.
My name is Leo, and my favorite thing is able to watch the sunset without freezing.
My name is Bonnie, and my favorite thing is more dogs in the park.
My name is Jordan. It may not feel as much of a blessing today, but the later evenings, for sure.
My name is Annie, and I love more people in the parks.
My name is Rhonda, and I love the growing birds.
I am Diana Woodland. I love many things, but yeah, all the flowers.
Hi, I'm Franklin Woodland, and I love riding my bike along the lakefront. There's more light and it's warmer.
I am Ismael, and I would say I love the flowers in bloom.
Hi, I'm Steven. Probably more time frames than outside.
Excellent. Well, thanks, you guys. We're excited for you to take this this step today in becoming members at Holy Trinity Church. I've got a couple of questions for you, and if you would affirm them after each one. First, do you acknowledge yourselves to be sinners in the sight of God, justly deserving his wrath, and without hope save his sovereign mercy? Do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as the Son of God and Savior of sinners, and do you place your faith and trust in him alone for salvation as he is offered in the gospel? Do you believe the scriptures, the Old and New Testaments, as originally given, to be the inerrant word of God, the only infallible rule of faith and practice? Do you now resolve and promise in humble reliance upon the grace of the Holy Spirit that you will endeavor to live as followers of Christ? Do you promise to support this church in its worship and work to the best of your ability? Finally, do you submit yourselves to the government and discipline of the church and promise to study its purity and peace? Amen. That's wonderful. At this time, if I could have any of the elders who are present this morning to begin to make their way up forward, we're going to lay hands on them, and Jesse is going to pray for them. Thanks.
All right. Will you guys pray with us? Father, we come to you, and we just praise you for your big global church, God. And how you have invited people ultimately into your family, God, because you desire to care for your sheep and to see them transform from one degree of glory to another. God, we pray for these congregants right now of HTC. I pray that they would get integrated well, feel loved by the congregation here in such a lonely and transient city, that they would plug in well and feel like they belong. And God, I pray you plant their feet, establish their roots, and help them build no matter how long they might be in this city.
God, we thank you for them. We praise you for their life because ultimately they belong to you, God. Would you help us as a congregation care for them, shepherd them, and move them forward? Lord, I pray today they feel loved and celebrated because, God, they are an image of you. And so, Father, we praise you for who you are and for these lives up here. And as a member of HTC, I pray that you help us love and care for them well. God, all for your glory alone and your praise. Amen.
Amen. Amen. All
right, so now you can stand, and I want to invite you to greet your neighbor or these people. Invite them to lunch after church if you even have time. All right? You guys can be seated.
Good morning. I would like to encourage you to find a seat and hang tight while I have some announcements for you. And I promise you there will be plenty of time after service today to continue conversing with one another. Well, good morning. My name is Christian Park, and I welcome you to HTC this morning. I'm the Director of Intentional Christian Communities and Sunday Operations. If you're new here, welcome. We are so glad that you chose to come on this Spring Forward Sunday. And if you are new here, if you could fill out the bottom portion of the bulletin and put it in the offering bag as it comes around, we would love to stay connected with you after service and sometime this week. A few announcements for you. First, are you interested in learning more about HTC's marriage ministry? Well, Re-Engage is an opportunity to study individually as a couple and in a confidential, authentic group setting of how God would have us live our married lives. It's a discipleship curriculum encouraging couples to grow as disciples of Jesus Christ and to see their marriages through the lens of the gospel. So join us tomorrow night, Monday, March 11th at 7 p.m. for an informational session via Zoom. You could go ahead and register on our website. And the next announcement, have you ever wondered how we should look at healthcare through the lens of the gospel, but we couldn't make it on Saturday, March 16th? Well, Faith and Work postponed our second workshop in our industry series to have a discussion how to think, speak, and act biblically regarding our bodies, health, and our approach to healthcare. So stay tuned for a rescheduled date later in the spring. And then also, there's a booklet here for the Institute that you could pick up at the welcome table. I'm sorry, spring forward's like messing up my speech this morning. But on your way out, you could go ahead and pick up one of these on the table. And then are you looking for an opportunity to host people in your home? Well, as Easter approaches, HTC is excited to continue the tradition of hosting international students for an Easter meal. Please consider setting a few extra place settings at your table Easter weekend. Students will be available Saturday or Sunday, March 30th or 31st. This will be a great opportunity to share the hope of the gospel with a new friend from overseas. So please register by Sunday, March 17th, or you could contact Kim Travis for more information. And also, lastly, you could join us on Sunday, March 24th, for a service opportunity for those in need downtown and surrounding neighborhoods. The Compassion Ministry will be passing out Easter care packages around the church. So please meet at the church right next door at 218 South Wabash after the 11 a.m. service. And that is all the announcements I have. And if I could invite up Jeremy Kirk at this moment for a congregational prayer.
Please pray with me. Great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. Heavenly Father, we're thankful for this time to speak with you. You've promised to be here, and we pray that you would help us to be here too, present with you through faith. We need your help very much. Sometimes the significance of prayer is lost on us. But let that not be the case right now. Let your majesty and grandeur be in full focus for us as we humbly approach you. Lord, please drive out sin from our lives. Wash away whatever hinders us from knowing and delighting in you. Drive out selfishness and fill us with love for others. Drive out doubt and give us faith to sustain us through life's valleys. Drive out false thinking and saturate our minds and speech with truth. Please drive out greed and lust and pride. Lord, we have in many ways this week fallen short of your standard. We confess our sins to you now. Thank you so much for forgiving and forgetting each one of them. Lord, please strengthen the body of this church. Fellowship and community don't come easily in the city. So please create time and places for us to be with each other. Prod us to move past shallow talk, guide us into soul-challenging, love-motivated life together. Let our interactions be genuine. Please help our marriages. May they be relationships of joy, support, and sacrificial love. Please help us train our kids. Help us set an example of God-focused living so that they see that our priorities aren't on comfortable living. In our workplaces, please sustain us. Enable us to shine a light there. When we don't know what to say, please give us light. When we feel incompetent, show us your power. We know that all nations will come and worship you and that your righteous acts have been revealed, and so we know that you can come and change even the most obnoxious colleague or a rotten work culture. Father, we lift to you the cares and concerns of our world. For the immigrants in our city, please provide safe shelter, food, and health and work. In the wars in Ukraine and Gaza, please protect civilians. Please hasten peaceful ends to the conflicts. We trust that, as Proverbs says, the king's heart is a stream of water in the hand of the Lord. So we pray that you would direct the leaders toward peace and mercy. Now let us hear the teaching of your word and receive it like good soil, bearing fruit, growing, increasing, and yielding 30-fold, 60-fold, and 100-fold. To your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. It's at this time in our service that kids are dismissed for Kids City, so you guys can work your way out the back. And the rest of us, let's stand together as we continue in worship this morning.
Let's sing together.
Please remain standing for the reading of God's word.
Good morning. Our scripture reading today is taken from the book of Mark, chapter 5, verses 1 to 20. There's Bibles on the tables over at that end of the room, or that end of the room, or a scripture journal. Mark 5, verses 1 to 20. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. And when Jesus had stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. He lived among the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain, for he had often been bound with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. No one had the strength to subdue him. Night and day, among the tombs and on the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him. And crying out with a loud voice, he said, "What have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I adjure you by God, do not torment me." For he was saying to him, "Come out of the man, you unclean spirit." And Jesus asked him, "What is your name?" He replied, "My name is Legion, for we are many." And he begged him earnestly not to send them out of the country. Now a great herd of pigs was feeding there on the hillside, and they begged him, saying, "Send us to the pigs, let us enter them." So he gave them permission. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. The herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country. And people came to see what it was that had happened. And they came to Jesus and saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there, clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. And those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and to the pigs, and they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. As he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged him that he might be with him. And he did not permit him, but said to him, "Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you." And he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him, and everyone marveled. This is the word of the Lord. You may be seated.
Good morning. Welcome again to Holy Trinity Church. And if this is your first Sunday with us, welcome. And yes, you stumbled in on the Sunday. We're going to talk about an exorcism, okay? So welcome to Holy Trinity. One of the marks of secularism is the separation of facts and faith. The idea that there are these two realms. One is the scientific realm, and the other is the sort of religious realm, and that those two realms should not necessarily come together. It's actually a question that's existed for many years, all the way back to the North African church father and theologian Tertullian once famously asked, "What has Athens to do with Jerusalem?" And he was, in a sense, proposing this question: what does rationality have to do with Christian faith? To the modern educated world, Jesus is just a nice, fanciful, moral teacher who's influenced our culture, but he's not much more than that. It's interesting, there is a secular humanist philosopher who's contemporary, Luke Ferry. He's still alive. He wrote a short book called A Brief History of Thought, A Philosophical Guide to Living. But in it, he argues that actually, if you're a thinking person, you have to deal with who Jesus is. You have to understand the degree to which the ideas of Jesus have infiltrated culture to the point that they've actually shaped our modern understanding and our viewpoint. Particularly, say, in the idea of the value of a human individual and being created in the image of God. Here's what he says. He says, Christianity came up with answers to questions about morality which have no equivalent in Greek thought. So successful and so attractive and so indispensable that they convinced a large proportion of humanity and our culture. And so if you're an educated person, you still have to ask the question, what does Jesus have to do with me? Which is exactly what the demoniac asks in verse 7. What have you to do with me, Jesus? He wants to know. And Mark's argument is that Jesus is far more than just a teacher, which is what the disciples call him in chapter 4, teacher. And the question I want you to be thinking about is that very question. Jesus, what do you have to do with me? I'm going to ask you to bow with me in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we ask that you would show us more clearly today about this demon-destroying, commission-giving, marvel-making Son of the Most High God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As I mentioned at the beginning, our text is about nothing less than an exorcism. But it's more than an exorcism because here we have a demoniac that becomes a disciple. Here we have a man who's seized by a kind of chaotic mania who becomes a missionary by the end of the session. That Jesus so redeems him that he changes him and sends him on his way. Verse 7 is the central question. What have you to do with me? Actually, it's interesting. There's a number of questions that are asked in this section. If you look at the end of chapter 4, there's a question which says, who then is this that even the wind and seas obey him? I want you to picture the Sea of Galilee with me for a moment. The last chapter and a half have all surrounded the imagery of a boat. Mark centers the whole narrative on this boat. First, in the beginning of chapter 4, verse 1, Jesus is sitting in the boat and he is teaching. Just like a calm day. Christian mentioned how oftentimes when you're on a lake, your voice carries quite a distance. And so as Jesus is sitting on this, in this boat, on the water, his voice is carrying to a great crowd. It's no wonder that the disciples call him a teacher in chapter 4, verse 38, because that's what he's been doing. For, 34 verses, he's been teaching parable after parable after parable. And the people are starting to recognize, the crowd that's around him is starting to recognize his authoritative teaching, but they haven't necessarily seen his authority over various realms. And in the previous section, verses 35 to 41, Jesus shows his power over the natural world, over the wind and the waves. And here he shows his power over the supernatural world. The sea is a place of chaos in ancient imagery. And so Jesus moves from the chaos of the sea to the chaos of a man's soul. And he personalizes it. And essentially, Mark's making this claim that if this teacher can teach the wind and the waves, he can also teach this man who is filled with unclean spirits. Who is this that even the wind and waves obey him? One of the challenges of being a pastor is trying to resist the temptation to quote C.S. Lewis. And one of his most famous lines comes from Mere Christianity, and he says, I am here, trying to prevent anyone from saying the really foolish thing that people often say about him. I'm ready to accept Jesus as a great moral teacher, but I don't accept his claim to be God. Mark is saying, if you try to accept Jesus as only a moral teacher, you're rejecting Jesus as the Son of God. What does Jesus have to do with you? Take a look at verse 1. They came to the other side of the sea, to the country of the Gerasenes. The Gerasenes are just a region that's just east of the Sea of Galilee, and Mark is helping us to see a change of scenery and a new setting. And in the new setting, a conflict arises immediately in verse 2. Look at verse 2. And when Jesus stepped out of the boat, immediately there met him out of the tombs a man with an unclean spirit. Can you imagine that? As soon as you get out of the boat, there's this picture of chaotic, out of control mania. It says there met him a man out of the tombs. This man's rejected by the people. He has to live on his own in a graveyard, basically. It's the imagery of walking among the dead. The first zombie movie came out in 1919. A few have come out since then, including such movies as Pride and Prejudice and Zombies, starring Lily James and Sam Riley. I'm really pleased to say I never saw it, and if I'm missing anything, let me know. But what Mark is doing by introducing the tombs is saying this is one who walks among the dead. Walks among the dead. Someone who's been cut off from the land of the living. Who does Jesus bring the good news to? It's interesting because the imagery since chapter 4 in verse 12 is this imagery that some will see and not perceive, that some will hear and not understand. And to this point, the disciples are seeing, but they don't perceive. They're hearing, but they don't understand who this really is. And yet, throughout the Gospel of Mark so far, the ones who do know are the ones who exist in the spiritual realm. And they identify him time and time again in the Gospel of Mark. Verse 3 drills down even further among this. On this, he lived among the tombs. Even as the sea represented this place of chaos, so this man embodies psychological, physical, inhumanity, chaos. Look at the description of verse 3. No one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. So he'd been bound often with shackles and chains, but he wrenched the chains apart, and he broke the shackles in pieces. People were afraid of this man, this individual. It's the chaos of a human soul. He cannot be restrained by human power. No one, it says, verse 4, had the strength to subdue him. The chaos in this man is pervasive, but it's also highly personal. Look at the sadness that comes through in verses 5 and 6. Night and day among the tombs and in the mountains, he was always crying out and cutting himself with stones. The mountains are a place of peril also, a place of danger in some ways. We love to look at the mountains, but to go in the mountains as an ancient person represented danger. Clinically speaking, Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota says this: non-suicidal self-injury, often simply called self-injury, is the act of harming your own body on purpose, such as by cutting or burning yourself. It's usually not meant as a suicide attempt. This type of self-injury is a way to cope with emotional pain, sadness, anger, and stress. And while self-injury may bring a brief sense of calm and release of physical and emotional tension, it's usually followed by guilt and shame and the return of painful emotions. Life-threatening injuries are not usually intended, but it's possible that more serious and even fatal self-harm can happen. This is a man whose mind is not well. He's so unwell that he has to cut himself to find relief. And our culture today, it's a growing trend for people who have a kind of self-revulsion to cut themselves. This is the chaos of the human mind here taking over the human body. There's this confrontation in verse 2, but there's another confrontation, a further confrontation in verse 6. Which is interesting because rather than running from Jesus, the demoniac runs to Jesus. He knows somehow that he's met the Maker. And like an animal rolling over on his back in submission, he turns over, the demons do, in submission to Jesus. And when he saw Jesus from afar, he ran and fell down before him. The disciples are not mentioned at this moment, but we know they're there later in the text. Can you imagine that wild-eyed moment when he falls down? Mark includes this detail of him falling down because he's preparing to answer the question, what have you to do with me, Jesus? And the answer is surrender. He's about to surrender, not to a teacher, but to a healer. If Jesus is a teacher, there's no reason to fall down before him. You can sit at the feet of Jesus if he's a teacher, but you don't fall at the feet of Jesus if he's a teacher. You don't prostrate yourself before him like the disciples would do. You worship the Most High Son of God, but you don't worship a teacher. Mark is arguing since chapter 1 that Jesus is something, that he is the Christ, the King. This is verse 1, chapter 1, the Son of God. He's saying, you're not perceiving, disciples, who he really is. You're not seeing who he really is. You're not hearing who he really is. But Jesus sometimes opens eyes so that people see who he really is. Crying out with a loud voice, verse 7, what have you to do with me? Listen, Jesus, the Son of the Most High God. It's so interesting how Mark puts a couple questions in the text. Because the question at the end of the last text is, who is this? Who then is this that even the wind and the waves obey him? And the answer comes a little bit later. He's Jesus, the Son of the Most High God. The question of what Jesus has to do with you revolves, it pivots around the identity of Jesus. If he's a, you know, even today, if you come into the presence of royalty, there's a little bow that you have to do. Haven't you watched The Crown? Like they do this little bow like that, right? Why do you do that? It's a sign of reverence. It's a sign of sort of submission. Mark is saying that this man who's possessed by demons knows who he is. He can see and perceive. You can reject the teachings of, if Jesus is a moral man, you can reject his teachings. You can decide that you don't like the teachings of Jesus on about the kingdom. You can even reject Jesus as the King of Kings, but that does not change him as being the King of Kings. That's a call to recognize who he is, which is what he's doing here. If he's the King of Kings, then you should bow before him. You should do what we've been doing, which is to worship him. The demoniac is perhaps a little confused about Jesus' intentions. He says, I adjure you by God, do not torment me. But Jesus is clear. He came to heal this man's torment. He came to clean out this man's uncleanness. He came to calm this man's chaos. If Jesus can calm the wind and the waves, let me tell you that he can calm your will. If he can calm the chaos of the storm, he can calm the chaos of your spirit. He is this wave-commanding, demon-destroying Son of the Most High God. The structure of these two sections a little bit reminds me of Psalm 46 as I was meditating on it, which starts with what happens if the mountains fall into the sea? There's a stream that makes glad the rivers of God. And then that little piece that says, be still and know that I am God. That's where this is all going to. The stillness of recognizing who Jesus is. Verse 8, for he was saying to him, come out of the man, you unclean spirit. The concept of unclean spirit possibly has some kind of Jewish background to it, that where there's a lot of strict laws about cleanness and uncleanness, but it symbolizes the place of the dark, the place of demonic influence. And then to show Jesus' authority, in verse 9, he says, and what is your name? The concept of asking a name is there's a sense in which he has now authority over him. And the demon knows that. The first movie, The Exorcist, came out in 1973. Then in 1977, the second one. Then the third one in 2000. Fourth one in 2005. Then they did some prequels. But anyway, on October 6, 2023, the last one came out, but exorcism goes a long way back before that. This is the moment when the Son of the Most High has the power to set a man free. The man replies, and it's hard to imagine this without picturing sort of the man's vocal cords convulsing, his body shaking, and he says, my name is Legion, for we are many. And coursing through his lungs and his vocal cords is all the demonic power that's within him. And then the narrative unfolds with the demoniac begging Jesus not merely to release him, or the demon saying, please don't just cast us into the air, but into something else, into this great herd of pigs. And so he gave them permission, verse 13. And the unclean spirits came out and entered the pigs, and the herd, numbering about 2,000, rushed down the steep bank into the sea and drowned in the sea. This is the conquering power of Jesus. Mark has been arguing that Jesus has authority over every realm. He has teaching authority. He has authority over nature. He has authority over the demonic, over the supernatural world. He said, look, there's no realm where Jesus does not have power. Jesus is not some retiring, tweed-wearing professor in some university that knows this much about something about this wide. He's got an incredible kind of authority. Anyway, Lewis goes on and says, this is the one thing we must not say. A man who is merely a man and said the sort of things that Jesus said would not be a great moral teacher. He would either be a lunatic on the level with a man who says that he is a poached egg. If your friends say that about themselves, talk to the elders. You can talk to Sully about that. Or else you would be the devil of hell. You must make your choice. Either this man was and is the Son of God, or else a madman or something worse. You can shut him up for a fool. You can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But don't come with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. and he did not intend to. The power of Jesus, verse 14, the herdsmen fled and told it in the city and in the country, and the people came to see what had happened. Both in the calming of the sea and in the healing of the demoniac, the response is fear, because they don't have categories for teachers who do this kind of thing. And then look at the restoration of the soul in verse 15. This man who is chaotic is now a man who's nicely dressed. His hair's combed. Some of the other accounts of this in Matthew and Luke say that the man's naked. Verse 15, they came to Jesus and they saw the demon-possessed man, the one who had the legion, sitting there clothed and in his right mind, and they were afraid. It was weird. Like, they should be afraid before. Now they're afraid because he's well-dressed. When you truly encounter the power of the Son of God, the Son of the Most High, fear is the right and natural response. You see what it says in verse 7? It says, what have you to do with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God, not some little idol, creator of the universe, majestic, powerful, authoritative. That's why they're afraid. It's like, where did this come from? In verse 16, they beg him to depart. And so those who had seen it described to them what had happened to the demon-possessed man and the pigs. And they began to beg Jesus to depart from their region. Plus, like, they just lost a lot of money. These are their pigs. They're about to sell them. All that bacon wasted in the sea, right? They're a little fearful, but they also like, we don't want this guy around. He's going to keep impeding our financial profitability. What have you to do with Jesus? Or what does Jesus have to do with you? He came to rule. He didn't only come to calm the mind, but he came to rule the spirit. You can't have Jesus as your teacher without having him as your ruler. You can't have him as your healer without having him as your king. And sometimes we want one without the other. Jesus, please help me with this. Fix this. But you stay over there and I will stay over here. They go together. Some of you today maybe are struggling with who Jesus really is. And we make a mockery of him if we just treat him as a moral teacher. There's something really sweet about verse 18. Look at verse 18. And as he was getting into the boat, the man who had been possessed with demons begged that he might be with him. I love that part. He met the King of Kings and the ruler of rulers. He met the Son of the Most High God, and he's like, could I be with you? Let me be with you. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of Glory. The King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of Glory, the King above all things. He brings our chaos back into order. He makes the orphan a son or daughter. Here's a new son of the Most High King who wants to be with his brother, with the one who brings him to the Father. Jesus said, if you are weak, you should come to him. We can always run to Jesus. That's what this guy did. The demoniac ran to Jesus. Why? Because the Lord is good and faithful, and he will keep us day and night. And then the striking response in verse 19. Nope. Can't be with me. There's some higher calling that this healed man has. Some greater purpose. This man who had no purpose other than self-destruction is given the chance to speak of the mercy of God to other people, to tell a little bit of the story to those who can't see. He's going to help them see. To those who don't understand, he's going to help them understand. Jesus didn't just want to restore his soul. He wanted to revive his purpose, to revive his humanity, to revive his dignity. However chaotic your mind is, however uncertain your spirit is, he can take the manic and make them a missionary. Now, you're not going to be fully healed. The kingdom does not fully come until the last day. And there's a need in our culture today, yes, for medicine to calm a frenzied spirit. But there's a day coming when that medicine is needed no more. Jesus came not merely to heal, but to be known, to be made known, to be made much of. Much of the way in the teaching of religion can feel constricting and legal and binding. And Jesus is this unbinding, good news bringing person. Jesus wants us to obey him, but he also wants to free us. So he says, nope, go tell your friends what's happened. Go do relational evangelism, I think is what it says in the Greek. I'm not sure. Verse 19, he says, go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you and how he has had mercy on you. Sometimes you meet people and you're like, you get almost tired of their God talk. I'm sorry, not really, but they're like always saying how much God has done for them. My parents are like that. I love my parents. But every time you talk to them, it's like, and the hand of the Lord did this. And did they have like milestones, like they'll pull out their milestones of what God has done. And then on this day, on March 24th, 1983, God did this. Why? Because they love to speak about how much the Lord has done for them. Their identity has been shaped into this marvel-making God. Verse 20, and he went away and began to proclaim in the Decapolis how much Jesus had done for him. And look at that. And everyone marveled. What do you have to do with me, Jesus? Everything. Every part of you is governed by, belongs to, will be healed by Jesus. He is your healer. He is your king. He's your forgiver. He's your soul restorer. He's the place. I told someone that my title of my sermon is The Marvel Making God, and they wanted to know if I was going to mention Marvel. No, I'm not going to. What do you have to do with me, Jesus? The idea of repentance, which comes from Mark 1:15, is that everything changes. It's like a Copernican revolution. You're not at the center anymore. Somebody else is at the center. And so now everything about you changes in conformity with the one who's called you and given you a new identity and is going to heal you or is in the process of healing you. Jesus is the demon-destroying, soul-restoring, marvel-making, purpose-giving, commissioning Son of the Most High God. And that's what we need to do, is marvel at Jesus. The Lord is good and faithful. He will keep us day and night. Who else commands all the hosts of heaven? Who else could make every king bow down? Who else can whisper in darkness trembles? Only a holy God. Come and behold him, the one, the only. Cry out, sing holy, forever a holy God, the Son of the Most High God. Let us be a marvel-making church. He is a marvel-making God. Let us be a community that marvels at what he has done. Together in worship on Monday throughout the week, let's remember what he has done for you. Let us be a soul-restoring church. Let's be on the side of those who live near death in the tombs. Let's be for the cutters, those who cry out, the chaotic, those whose lives are marked by chaos. Let's be for them. The Son of the Most High God was for them. Let's be a friend finding church. Let's tell of what he has done to our friends. Tell them how much the Lord has done for us. Keep a list. Be slightly obnoxious about telling people what God has done for you and how he's had mercy on you. Go home to your friends and tell them how much the Lord has done for you, how he had mercy on you. And let's tell 10 cities about it. Decapolis means 10 cities. So it's like this little region, the Gerasene region, and then he goes to 10 cities. This is like circuit riding. This is like Tim Keller talking about the importance of cities and that we need to go to city centers. But let's realize not everything is as you see. Just because you can't see it with your eyes or touch it with your hands doesn't mean that it does not exist. Just because you can't measure it doesn't mean it's not real. Let's sit at the feet of the teacher and receive his word. Let's fall at the feet of the teacher and worship him because he's a king. Let's fear, but also have hope. In his book, Jesus and the Disinherited, Howard Thurman writes that fear is one of the most persistent hounds of hell, the dog that dogs the footsteps of the poor, the dispossessed and the disinherited. It's a mood that one carries around. When you first realize that Jesus is king, you're struck with fear. But when you realize that he's calling you as a daughter or a son, you're filled with hope. So tell your friends. What have you to do with me, Jesus? The answer is everything. Why? Because he is the demon-destroying, soul-restoring, mind calming, wave commanding, mission giving, marvel making, Son of the Most High God. He's done much for us. Let's make much of him. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for the stunning power of Jesus, which sometimes in our intellectual and day-to-day world seems far off. So thank you for the old stories that tell us of who he really is. And we pray that our lives would be ordered around this one, around Jesus, the Son of the Most High God. In the name of Jesus we pray, amen.
Amen. Would you stand with us as we sing in response to our holy God?
Who else commands?
Shines the sun. What other name remains undefeated? Only a holy God, only the Son of the Most High God. And He came to rescue you from your failings, to cleanse out your uncleanness, to lift you up after you have fallen down in worship, and send you out to declare the good news and the good deeds, the good things that He has done for you. Now to Him who is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you blameless before the presence of his glory with great joy. To the only God, our Savior, through Jesus Christ our Lord, be glory, majesty, dominion, and authority before all time and now and forevermore. Amen. If you have some chaos that you need some people to pray about for you, if you have some unsettledness of mind, or you just want to pray with somebody, Christian and Jeremy are there to pray with you. Go in peace.